the moonlight dances on the street. And the city's quiet and complete. You can hear a symphony so sweet. Whispers in the night can't be beat. In the shadowed
corner. My name is Yann LeCun. I'm a professor at New York University and the chief scientist of Meta's fundamental AI research lab. People often call me one of the godfathers of AI because I've always believed in the power of neural networks, the ability of machines to not be explicitly programmed to do something, but to basically learn how to do something. Those methods now form the foundation of modern artificial intelligence. But those ideas were dismissed for many years.
Every word a charming little thing, holding on to dreams.
What we are seeing today is a dramatic shift as the world embraces those approaches that my colleagues and I began exploring almost 40 years ago.
Midnight's magic makes the heart relent. Promises of moments well spent in the twilight haze.
Here is my story.
I'm Barbara Rosario for AI Stories, and I'm in Paris with Yann LeCun, your friend. You studied right here at the Sorbonne.
In your PhD thesis, you proposed an early form of the backpropagation learning algorithms for neural networks. So you were an early pioneer.
I got interested in machine learning while I was an undergrad. This was a very unpopular area at the time. I could not find anybody here in France who were working on neural nets. People like John Hopfield, I read papers by Jeff Hinton, Terry Sanofsky. Those are the two papers that won the Nobel Prize this year in physics. I wanted to meet them because they understood where I think the problem was, which was to be able to train neural nets with multiple layers. That really was something that people in the 60s hadn't figured out how to do. The people I was working with organized a workshop in the winter 1985. What I got to do also is meet Terry Sanofsky. He goes back to the US, talked to Jeff Hinton, saying there's some kid in France who are doing the same stuff we're doing. A few months later, Jeff Hinton was invited to a conference in Paris. It turns out he had read my paper in the proceedings that was written in French. Oh. But he kind of reads French and the math was clear and he had figured out this was a material neural net. And he said, you're going to graduate about the same time. Why don't you come to Toronto and do a postdoc with me?
So that was during your postdoc with Jeff Hinton that deep learning started.
We didn't call it deep learning then. It was known as neural nets. Bell Labs is a legendary place, you know, that's where essentially all the technology of the modern world was invented. So I get there in October 1988, and within a month or two, I get the best results that everybody has ever gotten on that data set. We tried to build a kind of a demo out of it, and now we had a demonstrable system where we could just put a sheet of paper under a camera and hit a key and it would recognize all the characters at maybe a few characters per second.
In the night can't be beat. In the shadowed corners, secrets lie. Lovers find their moments passing by. Underneath the stars, they always sigh. Kisses like the moon's soft lullaby. Oh, the moonlit whispers softly sing. Every word a charming little thing.
So we started turning this into a product, and they built a system to read checks. The first one, interestingly, was a system that was deployed in ATM machines where you can deposit a check and it kind of reads the amount on the check. We knew this had a lot of applications. What we did not realize was how complicated it would be to convince other people that this was so good. It was very difficult to reproduce. Everybody was using different computers, different operating systems, different programming languages. We had something that worked, but we could not really kind of share with other people.
What then turned actually deep learning into a mainstream technology?
In 2003, I became a professor at NYU. I restarted a research program on neural nets. I said, you know, those techniques really work and we need to revive the interest of the community into those methods by demonstrating that they work. People were making fun of us because we were working on neural nets. And we started changing the name. Because neural net had a bad reputation and really was kind of a little too restrictive for the kind of stuff we were doing, we changed the name and we called it deep learning. There was first real success in the late 2000s for speech recognition. And it was largely due to Jeff Hinton. He basically had a bunch of students and he placed three of his students as interns in each company that had some of the top speech recognition engines. Okay, so one went to Microsoft, one went to Google.
Well, the mastermind.
And one went to IBM. Okay, and their mission was take their engine, speech recognition engine, and just replace the part that's called acoustic modeling by a deep learning system. And they all got better results. And within 18 months of those first experiments running, every smartphone basically was using deep learning for speech recognition. Paris is the sort of highest concentration of AI startups, but also high-tech startups in Europe. In part because there's a lot of local talents, but also in part because France is a very centralized country, so there's a high concentration in Paris. That has made Paris kind of a hotbed for innovation. And there's a high concentration, of course, of high quality science and engineering schools with a very strong tradition of applied mathematics, computer science. So all of this conspires to really kind of make this ecosystem very vibrant.
We are now inside Station F, the world's biggest startup campus, the perfect location to talk about innovation in the private sector. Do you think that Europe and France in particular can keep up with the US and China and in AI development?
I really think that the question should not be formulated this way, because what we are seeing is not a competition between regions, but more a competition between the open research, open source world and the proprietary world. If you take the example of Llama, which is the open source foundation model that Meta puts out, the first version came out of Paris. Because Meta is an American company, does that mean that the US is ahead of everyone? Or does that mean that Paris is ahead of everyone? And the answer doesn't matter. It really is the open research and open source community moving faster and progressing faster than the companies that choose to be secretive and not reveal what they're doing.
You also said that it is unacceptable for many governments that the digital life of their citizens be controlled by the handfuls of companies. Do you ever feel a tension between your work as a corporate researcher and the work as independent scientist?
Right now I have a foot in both, right? I'm a part-time professor and chief AI scientist at Meta. The reason why I work at Meta and not anywhere else is because Meta is very adamant about open research. I don't see such a big tension because everything we do can be published. Every time I talk to people in industry, not just startups, but large companies, they are migrating to using Llama or other open source foundation models to build their products. Since summer 2023, the Llama family has been downloaded a total of something like 800 million times. 800 million times. It's just astonishing.
You're a member of French Academy of Science, whose headquarters are right here in this beautiful building in front of the River Seine. In 2023, the President of France made you a Chevalier of the French Legion of Honor. You received numerous prestigious awards, including the Turing Award, which is also called the Nobel of Computer Science. How did the Turing Award change your work priorities and your personal life?
It's wonderful to receive all this recognition, of course. I mean, the Turing Award particularly, since I received it with my friends, Yosha Benjo and Jeff Hinton, it's given me a little bit of influence, perhaps. Whenever I say that something is interesting or uninteresting, there's more people listening to this than before.
How should the AI communities approach the challenge of creating systems that are not only efficient, but also aligned with societal values?
I think it's a difficult question, but I don't think it's as difficult as what many people have made it to be. There is some argument that, you know, once AI system becomes truly intelligent and is smarter than humans, maybe they will escape our control. I don't think that's true. I don't think the problem of aligning their behavior to ours is a simple problem, but I think it's just an engineering problem that we need to solve. The same way we've solved in the past the problem of, you know, how do you make airliners and turbojets safe? I've been making proposals for completely new architectures that I call objective-driven architectures, where you give a goal to the system and it has guardrails, and the only thing the system can do is fulfill these goals.
You're proposing a technical solutions to those concerns.
The idea that intelligence is correlated with a desire for dominance is just false. It's even false within humans. It's not the smartest humans who want to be the chief. If we look at politics, it's actually kind of the opposite. Those systems are going to be built so that they serve us. We set objectives to them, we set goals for them, and they fulfill those goals subject to the guardrails. Maybe some people somewhere will screw up and design a very smart, powerful system without the proper guardrails. But then there is other people who will be able to build even smarter systems that will have the proper guardrails and will take down those rogue AI systems. It's going to be, you know, my good AI against your bad AI. Like, I think ultimately society is going to do the right thing. People are going to demand it. Amplifying human intelligence, I think, is the best thing we can do for humanity. That has to be intrinsically good. It might have an effect on society similar to the appearance of the printing press in the 15th century, which had the effect of amplifying human intelligence, right? So maybe this is a new renaissance that we're going to see. I mean, I'm dreaming a little bit here. This is a little cosmic, but why not?
Why not? That's the right place for thinking big.
Exactly. Yeah.
Thank you.
I use social media for lots of different things. I post things that I find fun or interesting, about music, about art, about anything. Videos of animals doing things that you would not expect animals to do, because I'm really intrigued by the level of intelligence of animals. You know, we think animals are stupid, we think about superhuman AI, but are we intelligent enough to know how intelligent animals are?
Now you live in New York. What do you miss the most about France?
Paris is, you know, family and friends that I would have behind. What I miss is the culture, the places like this one, you know, the food. This is a brasserie, like traditional Alsatian brasserie. I'm actually a quarter Alsatian. My maternal grandmother was from Alsace, and when she was born in 1900, that part of France was actually belonged to Germany. She always spoke with a very heavy German accent, basically. She made a choucroute, which is kind of a traditional dish from Alsace. I found that here, you know, that's a little bit of nostalgia.
Is there anything that people might be surprised to learn about you?
I have a bunch of hobbies. I like sailing. I got this from my dad. Our dad was a mechanical engineer. He was kind of an inventor. He got that into us somehow. And that has a lot to do with the fact that we're both scientists. My brother and I like building flying contraptions of various kinds. So we build airplanes, we build helicopters, we fly them, we crash them, not necessarily deliberately, but we like to build like unusual things that you wouldn't think could fly.
So that's why we cannot fly drones on Paris now.
No, it's not my fault. You know, creating something with your hands and then having kind of fly, that's really sort of a engineering ability. So that, I think that's how I kind of learned engineering a little bit. And then I also have a big interest in music. I have very eclectic tastes. I like classical music. I like Baroque music very much. I used to play Renaissance and Baroque music. I like also contemporary classical music like Stravinsky, But I'm a huge fan of jazz, particularly bebop and hard bop. So this is jazz from the kind of 50s and 60s, and also kind of contemporary jazz. I really hope to inspire young people to be positive and optimistic. Don't let negative or scary stories stop you. They're designed to attract attention, to discourage action, and they may lead you to passively accept what is handed to you. Instead, recognize your power and take charge of building the future you want to see. Don't let anyone tell you that you can't be part of the next big innovation or that smaller projects aren't valuable. Even a simple idea, if it matters to you and you believe in it, can make a difference. There are countless opportunities for you to shape the life you want. It's not up to me, it's not up to Meta, it's not up to those currently in power, but it's up to you.